question is if civil society is still a force for change. Of course, it's the people is a force of change, and civil society is the people. The questioning of the concept civil society, I think, came after the idea that civil society was only represented by NGOs, and that limited the idea of civil society, because it became a structural way of understanding civil society. So that questioning was a logical questioning. Only those that are capable of putting together an NGO can be so-called civil society, and that, of course, brought about an entire debate. I come from Venezuela, and in Venezuela, over the past 15 years, there has been a gradual process of dismantling democracy. Dismantling democracy as we know it for two pillars, basic pillars. The one, the legitimacy of the votes, and the second, which was discussed in the earlier panel, the legitimacy of how democracy works. That has many things. The equilibrium between the different powers of the state, respect for human rights, freedom of speech, human dignity as the goal of democracy. All those issues have been dismantling progressively in Venezuela, with the idea that those that were governing with the support of the people, because they were winning elections, 18 elections in 14 years. That was a half-truth up until last April, when we won the election and the government actually stole the election, as the last panel also said, happens in democracies, in some democracies with bad governments. The idea of civil society for us is key in the Venezuela that we have today. My friend Antonio Gonzalez, I think he's here from Cuba, this morning he asked a question and he said, how do we bring about change if there is a fragmentation between the state and the individual? And everything that is between the state and the individual is fragmented. It has been blown away. Everything, universities, unions, student movements, it has been either or paralleled by the government with a parallel institution or taken away as illegal or basically dismantled. So that's a reality that we're facing. So how do we bring about change? Change has to do with an idea. Change in itself is not forceful enough. It's not committing enough to have millions of people go to the streets or go out to vote. So we need to have a clear idea of what change is about. And what we have been putting together through our alliance of political parties and social organizations called the Unity, or our own political party that's called People's Will, is a very simple idea. Very old, very talked about, but not brought about to a reality, at least in our country. All rights for all the people. Very simple, but very powerful. All the rights, not part of the rights, for all the people. And for us, that's the common thread that all the fights of different groups of people, of different individuals, can find in a society that has to fight against the power of the state. Because that's the only way in which people with very different origins, very different realities, and very different interests can be brought about together. The interest of the fishermen from the coasts that is being taken away the opportunity to go out and fish because of a new law, or the interest of the producers of the planes that have been expropriated, or the interest of a reporter that has been kicked away from the TV channel because of his political position, or the owner of the media that has been expropriated, or the interest of the gay and lesbian groups that are fighting for recognition. If you look at that spectrum, all those issues are very, very different from each other. But one thing they have in common, one thing, they are all fighting for a specific right, either for the right of freedom of speech, or the right of property, or the right of recognition, or the right for marriage, or the right for work, or the right for having healthcare, or education, or housing, or an environment. So that one thing that for each individual or group can be very different from each other has to become, in our way of understanding, the counterweight that we need to build against a very powerful, and even more powerful when you have oil at $110 per barrel and you have an oil country, that one idea that all the people are brought together by their common defense of their rights is a very powerful idea. Because then we can say, we are fighting for you. It doesn't matter what right, specific right we represent. We need to make the idea that all the people are fighting for all the people's rights. And that idea becomes very powerful when you put together the workers with the students, with the people that have been affected by the media, with the producers. And they all understand that even though they may have different origins, even though they may have different ways of understanding the future, the only way they can picture a common future is by picturing that future in terms of the rights. So then comes another question. Well, what type of society is a society that is capable of delivering all the rights for all the people? Mm. And I don't want to go into the depth of all the issues that are being discussed in this forum, but I want to signal out three issues that are key. The first is we need to compromise with good government, efficient government. It's not enough to have a good constitution. There was a debate in the previous panel. I had a conversation with Mr. de Klerk this morning, and he was telling me that their fight was for a new system that had to be reflected in a new constitution. That's not the problem that we have in Venezuela. We have a good constitution. All the rights are expressed in the constitution in paper. All the rights are supposedly defended by the institutions that are also in that constitution. But the reality is very different. So the reality to make all the rights for all the people needs an efficient government that has accurate political and public policies to deliver what the aspirations of those rights are in the constitution. But that's not enough, because that could mean the rights for part of the people. In order to have all the rights for all the people, you need a judiciary system, you need justice, that it's nothing less than all the rights are equal to all the people. So if you have a system that is not a democracy, you will not have all individuals being equal versus their own rights. So that's the second key issue in order to bring about a government or a system where all the rights for all the people are respected. And the third, that is very common for us, or it's very very close to our reality, being in the opposition to a very autocratic government, is the will to fight for the rights, the will to fight, the will to defend the rights, the will to agitate the conscience of the people in order for those that don't recognize that their rights are being taken away, those rights to become the source of their action. No, it's not enough to be indignado, to be, I don't know how you say that word in English, to be
indignant.
Pissed off.
Pissed off.
To be, that's a translation. Yeah. It's necessary.
A Spanish niche here.
Yeah, to make the change towards action. We need to make that sense of not being capable of doing anything into action. And that's, of course, in the realm of civil society. And in order to, three other ideas, very quick. Force. How can we make the civil society a force, a strong force? I think there are three key elements. The first is that it needs to have a tangible and a timely proposal. Tangible. It's not, we cannot have an abstract proposal, a better world. Everybody wants a better world. Communists and capitalists, they all promote a better world. We need to promote something very tangible, something that people can see. That means a better housing system, or that means a healthcare system, or an education system that allows you to progress, or public safety, tangible things that you're willing to fight for, and timely. Timely. Why timely? Because in order for these groups of civil society to activate, change needs to be in the short-term horizon. And I think this is part of the discussion that we need to have, because I think that there are different positions around the time horizon issue hearing different speakers this morning. I believe that we need to present a short-term time horizon in order for the people to take risks. People will not take risks for a fight that is in the long term. People will not risk their lives. In my country, we are risking our lives. I have been threatened in many ways. I have had murder attempts. I have been threatened to being in prison, as many others.
So in order to take risk,
that change needs to be tangible. The second is the capacity to communicate. And I think that Michael was talking about this new revolution of the way we can communicate. But that communication, it's also not enough. And goes to the third issue, which is the grassroots organization. Grassroots organization is key. And we may be in an age where the media creates a sensation of grassroots organized society. But we cannot be flashed away by the Twitter or the 2.0 or the social media that's equal to grassroots organization. Grassroots organization needs people touching people, needs people talking to people, needs people in specific places doing specific things. And I think that is something that we need to promote permanently, that we need to focus strategically as a source for change. So those are some of the thoughts on civil society as definitely a force for change. Thank you.